Item number, SCP-006. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. Whereas the nature of SCP-006 does not warrant any extensive containment, a certain level of secrecy is necessary regarding the object's existence and properties, for obvious reasons. The following procedures are required not for personnel safety, but to deny or hide knowledge of SCP-006's effects from the personnel who interact with it. 1. All personnel interacting with SCP-006 in any physical way are required to wear modified Class 6 BNC suits. Before personnel are allowed to perform procedures, they must be briefed with material SCP-006-B or SCP-006-C. SCP-006-A briefing is the correct one, and is restricted to only those with O5 clearance. To ensure personnel are wearing suits properly, they are to be submerged into a pool of water. Any air bubbles spotted signify a leak in the suit. 2. Procedures with SCP-006 are to be carried out under extreme surveillance. In case of contact with SCP-006, the commander in charge will announce procedure 006-G12, which the personnel have been briefed to believe to mean high toxicity is present and they must evacuate. 3. Any procedure in which liquid is acquired from SCP-006 must be approved by 305 level personnel. The liquid is to be transferred in a quad sealant container and under armed guard. 4. If at any time personnel come into contact with SCP-006 or liquid from SCP-006, they are to be confined and terminated after sufficient studies are done. Due to the nature of SCP-006, the most effective termination method is incineration. For full report, see file SCP-006-TER-05. Description: SCP-006 is a very small spring located 60 kilometers west of Ostrakhan. Foundation Command was aware of its existence since the 19th century, but were unable to secure it until 1991 due to political reasons. On the spot of the spring, a chemical factory has been constructed as a disguise, with the majority of laborers under Foundation and/or Russian control. The liquid emitted from the spring has been chemically identified as simple mineral water in 1902, but has the unusual property of health. Ingesting the liquid produces the following properties in human beings: the ability to regenerate DNA damaged by sufficient duplication, heightened excitement of cellular duplication, vastly improved abilities in the repair of damaged tissue, and a frightening increase in the effectiveness of the human immune system. Upon testing the liquid on animal subjects, hostile bacteria and viral agents were destroyed immediately. Many reptiles and birds were unaffected, while higher primates experienced the same benefits as humans. Item number, SCP-109. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-109 is currently located in Non-Critical Storage Unit 7 and requires no active monitoring. It should not be removed from the unit except to be transported to a research facility, and then only by personnel with Level 3 security clearance or higher. When replacing SCP-109, personnel should ensure that it is firmly closed and that it is placed on the molded pedestal in the upright position. Description: SCP-109 is a standard-issue United States Army canteen circa 1899, made of a tin alloy, and fitted with a heavy cotton cover and a black leather strap. When opened, the item is seen to be nearly full of water. A seemingly unlimited amount of water can be removed from the container without changing the water level or the item's mass, which remains a constant 3.16 kilograms. Probes of the interior of the container reported an estimated volume of 2.8 liters and a shape consistent with the outside. The water in SCP-109 is of a slightly blue-gray tint, with concentrations of 20 ppm of tin and 170 ppm of other electrolytes. The water remains at a constant temperature of 19 degrees Celsius, but can be heated or cooled when moved to another container. Addendum 109-1. Upon the item's delivery to Site-19, it was given the object class of safe. As tests were conducted on the item, Uncertainty surrounding test results prompted General to upgrade the object class to Euclid. Addendum 109-2. Recently, a request was filed and granted by Dr. for permission to water an okra plant growing in his office with SCP-109. Staff should be notified that said doctor uses SCP-109 for this purpose for a small time every Friday. Addendum 109-3. It has come to my attention that new Class D personnel are often dared to empty the bottle. Guards are reminded that they are to discourage such activity and inform them that SCP-109 is bottomless. Chanting chug repeatedly is considered unprofessional. Dr. Klein. Additional information. Due to the range of tests conducted on SCP-109, this section has been provided to present test results in chronological order. Dates have been withheld for confidentiality. Test 1. Subjects imbibed water from SCP-109, reported that it was very refreshing and, despite the metal content, very tasty. Urine samples from subjects were normal. Test 2. Follow-up test to Test 1 had subjects dehydrate themselves for one full day before imbibing water from SCP-109. Test remains unfinished as subjects were unable to provide urine samples. Test 3. Subject bathed in water from SCP-109. Subject reported increased energy and a much improved complexion following the bath. Test 4. Streptococcus bacteria cultured in water from SCP-109 thrived and multiplied quickly. Water from SCP-109 administered to subjects suffering from streptococcal infection killed nearly all bacteria and produced a full recovery within 24 hours. Test 5. Blood substitute created using water from SCP-109, given in transfusion to pedestrian hit by a drunk driver. Subject showed no malign symptoms from the transfusion and made a full recovery. Subject's physical therapy concluded 6 weeks early. Test 6. Water from SCP-109 administered to various plant organisms, all of which remained very healthy and showed no malign symptoms. One proposition for a test which has been discussed for some time has been one involving a combination of SCP-109 and SCP-402. Due to the risk of losing one or both items or creating a hazardous situation, this test has never been conducted. Item number, SCP-198. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-198 is located in a secure room of site with armed guards posted outside to prevent any unauthorized access. SCP-198 is to be stored under 24-hour video surveillance in a sealed and locked case, 0.5 meters by 0.5 meters by 0.5 meters. And the key kept in a secured location accessible only to those personnel with level 3 clearance and above. Under no circumstances are any Foundation personnel to handle SCP-198. All handling of SCP-198 is to be done via remote robotic means, or by D-Class test subjects only. In light of Incident 198-A and Incident 198-B, Object Class has been elevated to Euclid, and Containment Protocol 198 has been established. SCP-198's case must now be kept on a digital scale, attached to an alarm system, with redundant backups for power in its secure room. Any deviations in weight will indicate a breach, and site supervisors must immediately enact Containment Protocol 198 detailed below. Description. SCP-198 has taken numerous forms since coming into Foundation possession in 19... Since acquisition, SCP-198 has been observed to have had dozens of different forms, including a styrofoam cup, a glass beer bottle, aluminum soda cans, an oversized shot glass that read 1 tequila, 2 tequila, 3 tequila, floor, a plastic water bottle with a label partially peeled off, and data expunged. These forms always appear partially filled with the expected liquid a vessel of that type would contain. Currently, SCP-198 appears as an ordinary white porcelain coffee mug, with blue vertical stripes evenly spaced around its exterior. There are no visible manufacturer markings or otherwise remarkable details about its appearance in its current form. The object has resisted all attempts at destruction or sampling for further analysis. When inactive, SCP-198 can hold the expected 240 milliliters, or 8 fluid ounces, of liquid that any standard coffee mug would hold. Anomalous behavior does not manifest until a live human being grasps SCP-198 to hold it. Approximately 2 to 5 seconds after the SCP is held, it will instantly bond itself through unknown, albeit painful, means to the handler's hand or hands. Test subjects have reported the pain of bonding with SCP-198 as a searing or fiery sensation, though no heat can be detected by outside observers or instruments. The use of gloves or other barriers between the object and the hand does not prevent the bonding process, so long as the subject can still grip SCP-198. Extensive testing has revealed that the bond appears to be at the molecular level, and is permanent until the death of its holder. To date, no means have been found to break the bond, including cutting or severing the fingers or hand of the holder, as any wounds below the wrist of the test subject heal instantaneously. Further proposed testing of the range of healing up the handler's arm is pending approval. Once bonded, any liquid inside SCP-198 will disappear, and the container will inexplicably begin to fill from the bottom up with a fluid, or a semi-solid material, stopping only once it reaches the top of the container. The liquid, or semi-solid, is different for each holder, but it has to date been a bodily fluid or human excretion in each test instance. Such instances have included human saliva, sweat, blood, bile, mucus, urine, feces, and data expunged, as well as combinations of two or more of these. Once SCP-198 has filled, the holder will undergo rapid dehydration and/or emaciation, becoming increasingly malnourished to the point of death, which usually occurs within 24 hours if nothing is done to prevent it. Ingestion of standard foods, liquids, or IV-supplied nutrients does nothing to reverse or slow this process. Testing has revealed that the only means by which the subject can gain nourishment is by consuming the contents of SCP-198. However, the constant rate of dehydration and emaciation remains the same, forcing the test subject to consume vast quantities of the excretions almost constantly to remain alive. As the contents are consumed, or, as is often the case, dumped out of the container, SCP-198 will continue to refill itself automatically. Test subjects have lasted as long as 70 hours by consuming the excretions, before finally succumbing to exhaustion or refusing to consume any more of the contents, which invariably leads to death. Upon expiration of the handler, the bond with SCP-198 is broken, and the object can once again be manipulated. In approximately 75% of test instances, SCP-198 will disappear once the bond is broken, and reappear almost instantly on a nearby flat surface, seemingly with a preference for tables or shelves within the same room, and take on a new form. Approximately 90% of these reappearances of SCP-198 are within the general vicinity of the now deceased handler, but several times the object has been observed to reappear in nearby containment rooms, observation rooms, and in one case, data expunged. Due to the catastrophic nature of that incident, extreme care is to be taken when in proximity to SCP-198's containment or testing room. Foundation personnel are urged not to bring with them any beverages or containers within 100 meters of SCP-198's containment room, even when the object is not actively being researched. SCP-198 was acquired by the Foundation from an underground bunker in Germany after the bunker's accidental discovery by construction workers. Reports of strange activity and deaths among the construction company regarding this bunker brought the object to Foundation attention. Agent, upon responding to the location, discovered several deceased and grossly emaciated corpses, both recent and some quite old. Unaware of the nature of their deaths, or the SCP in question, said agent sealed off the area and awaited backup. It was then that the nature of the SCP object revealed itself, as the agent mistakenly grabbed what appeared to be an unopened bottle of water from a table at the construction site. Backup arrived to find an extremely agitated agent vomiting and struggling to remove his hand from a cup full of fresh data expunged. Said agent later self-terminated during location cleanup. Incident 198-A. Date: undisclosed. Location: site. Description. At approximately 2:15 p.m., researcher John, who was working in an observation room adjacent to SCP-198's containment room, reached for what he thought to be his thermos of iced tea, only to discover he was firmly bonded to what appeared to be SCP-198. Immediately, researcher notified site supervisors who, upon inspection of containment room 198, discovered that SCP-198 was indeed missing from its case. At least 3 months had passed since the last experiment had been conducted on SCP-198 without incident. Researcher was interviewed by site's staff and was kept alive by consuming the contents of SCP-198 for 31 hours, before finally refusing to drink the contents any longer. Incident 198-B. Date: undisclosed. Location: site. Description: at approximately 8 a.m., security guard Albert stopped to get a cup of coffee from a break room, later determined to be located 3 floors underneath and 2 hallways over from SCP-198's containment room. The guard found himself bonded to SCP-198 when he attempted to grab a bottle of dairy creamer from the break room refrigerator. Once again, site supervisors were notified of a potential containment breach and discovered SCP-198's case to be empty. The guard was interviewed and chose to self-terminate rather than consume any of the contents of SCP-198. Immediately after Incident 198-B, site supervisors determined that the object class should be raised to Euclid, and Containment Protocol 198 was created to handle future containment breaches. Containment Protocol 198. Containment Protocol 198 is to be executed immediately by site supervisors after a containment breach of SCP-198 is detected. In the event that the alarm attached to SCP-198's scale is sounded, site is to be locked down, and all personnel are to immediately avoid any beverage containers and evacuate the facility until SCP-198 can be located and properly secured. Experiment Log 198-A. Experiment Log of Dr. on SCP-198, testing various manifestations of its anomalous properties. Notes: testing on SCP-198 is to be done outside of its containment room, in a secure experimentation room. SCP-198 is to be placed via robotic means on a plain table in the center of the otherwise empty room. During experimentation, all Foundation personnel are to remotely observe either via surveillance camera or adjacent observation room, behind a secure plexiglass window. At no time should any Foundation personnel enter the experimentation room while experiments are being conducted. Armed guards and cleanup crews will be posted outside the experimentation room and will not enter until the test subject has expired. Experiment 198-A-1. Date: undisclosed. Procedure: object is observed to have the form of a small glass of water. Class D personnel instructed to enter room and touch SCP-198 with his finger, but ordered not to hold or pick up the object. Results: no bonding takes place, and Class D personnel is unaffected. Experiment 198-A-2. Date: undisclosed. Procedure: same Class D personnel is instructed to pick up SCP-198. Results: Class D personnel screams in surprise as the bonding process takes place. Test subject immediately begins to try and pry SCP-198 from his hand. Test subject ordered to calm down and describe the contents of SCP-198. Doctor: please describe the contents of the object in your hand. Test subject: what the fuck is going on? I can't get it off. Liquid is seen spilling from SCP-198 as the test subject flails around. Doctor: yes, we are aware of the situation. Please calm down and describe the contents of the object in your hand. D-class personnel is seen to cautiously sniff the contents of SCP-198. Test subject: is that... oh god, that's disgusting, man. Test subject stumbles slightly and falls to one knee at this point. Doc, I don't feel so good, man. Doctor: please describe what you're feeling right now. Test subject: I feel weak, tired, thirsty too. What's going on? Can I get some water, man? Doctor, I'm sorry. I cannot do that. But perhaps the contents in your hand. Test subject. Are you f***ing kidding me, man? No f***ing way. Doctor, suit yourself. Approximately 2 hours into the experiment, the test subject is observed to curse loudly before gulping down the contents of SCP-198. Test subject periodically drinks from SCP-198 until finally succumbing to exhaustion and expiring 29 hours into the experiment. Subsequent autopsy determines the contents of the test subject's stomach to be mostly human urine. DNA profile on the urine came back inconclusive, and with no known match in our database. Upon death of the test subject, SCP-198 unbonded, disappeared, and returned to the table in the form of a large, half-filled plastic pitcher of what appears to be ice and lemonade. Experiment 198-A-3. Date: undisclosed. Procedure: Class D personnel instructed to enter room and don surgical gloves placed on the table next to SCP-198. Once the test subject is wearing the gloves, subject is instructed to pick up SCP-198, still in lemonade pitcher form, and pour herself a glass. Results: test subject is observed to use both hands to lift the pitcher to pour a drink. Once again, Class D personnel shouts in surprise as the bonding process takes place, despite the gloves, and appears to have both hands bonded to SCP-198. Test subject is highly agitated and clearly in pain. Test subject: ow, 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 ow! It burned me! Doctor: it would appear that both of your hands are stuck to the container. Is that the case? Test subject: yeah, does it look like I'm not stuck? Test subject is visibly straining to pull her hands apart from SCP-198. Doctor: can you remove your hands from the gloves? Test subject: no! They're stuck to this damn thing! The test subject pauses mid-sentence and stares at the pitcher in her hands. Seconds later, test subject is seen vomiting violently and falling to her knees. A brownish, semi-solid mass spills onto the floor from SCP-198. Doctor: can you please describe the contents of the pitcher, please? Test subject: expletives expunged. Test subject continued vomiting for approximately 10 minutes before collapsing to the floor. Test subject became uncooperative at this point and would not respond to the researchers' requests. Security guards are instructed to enter the experimentation room and terminate test subject. Testing concluded that the substance in question was human feces. Again, the DNA profile of the substance was inconclusive and matchless in our database. Upon death of the test subject, SCP-198 unbonded and remained in its lemonade pitcher form, once again half-filled with what appeared to be lemonade and ice, but did not teleport back to the table's surface. Item number: SCP-209. Object class: Euclid. Special containment procedures: SCP-209 is to be held in a 0.5 meter by 0.5 meter by 0.5 meter pressure sealed storage locker, insulated to prevent any potential aroma from release to the surrounding area. Access to SCP-209 is limited to a single Class 2 or higher staff member for any transport. A standard security detail should accompany any transport of SCP-209 at a distance of at least 23 meters. No more than one human subject of any classification should be within the minimum safe distance of 20 meters of SCP-209 at any time outside of a research trial setting. As current hypotheses regarding the function of SCP-209's active phase indicate enticement to use, through olfactory manipulation of some kind, any staff assigned to research trial or security detail should be equipped with personal air filtration devices rated at Foundation standards of at least Euclid 3, HEPA filter, oil resistant. Research has approved the use of the prototype modular keycard system, SC Passport, for SCP-209 storage locking mechanism. The keycard for SCP-209 storage is modified with a proximity alarm and deactivation protocol to enforce the single-user-only containment mandate. If more than one human subject is detected in the proximity of both the keycard device and lock, a level 1 containment breach alarm will be sounded, and the locking system disabled to prevent removal of SCP-209 from its storage locker. Description: SCP-209 appears to be a single malt scotch tumbler, 10 centimeters in height, and with an 8-centimeter diameter at its widest point. The tumbler shows no manufacturer's marks, but does indicate signs of moderate to heavy use and light wear, including a small chip missing from the rim. When not in the possession of a human subject, the tumbler contains approximately 88 to 91 milliliters, or 3 ounces, of an unknown golden-brown translucent liquid. This liquid cannot be siphoned, spilled, drained, evaporated, or otherwise removed from SCP-209 by any means, other than a human subject taking hold of the tumbler and consuming the liquid. All activator subjects debriefed following a sampling of the liquid produced by SCP-209 reported to be alcoholic in nature and providing of a sense of warmth, self-assurance, and general well-being. This effect has proven to be highly addictive, with methadone therapy currently holding the highest rates of success for detoxification from SCP-209's effects. For SCP-209 to enter its active phase, 3 conditions must be met. At least 2 human subjects must be within 20 meters of SCP-209. At least 1 of the human subjects must have a normal functioning sense of smell and detect SCP-209's aroma. Anosmic test subjects have been unable to initiate the active phase. The subject who first detected the odor of SCP-209 must take possession of the tumbler and consume any amount of the liquid within it. Hereafter, activator subject. Once these conditions are met, SCP-209 enters its active phase. The activator subject will immediately seek a relaxing or comfortable position in which to finish the liquid in SCP-209 at a leisurely pace. Any other human subject within 20 meters of the activator subject, hereafter prey subject, will be locked into 2 distinct physical parameters for the duration of the active phase. Prey subjects will be physically incapable of moving more than 20 meters away from the activator once ingestion has begun. Prey subjects will be physically incapable of moving closer than 1 meter to the activator once ingestion has begun. All current attempts at moving any prey subject beyond these boundaries while living have met with failure. Any descriptive word or phrase used in reference to SCP-209 by the activator subject during the active phase will physically reflect upon the prey subject in a variety of ways. See Experiment Logs 209-6.2 through 209-33.8 for details. Activator subjects seem aware of both the boundary restrictions imposed on prey subjects, as well as the physical effect of their descriptive language. But no matter the scale of physical harm or distress inflicted upon prey subjects, activator subjects seem to retain a light, amused demeanor. It is theorized that the effects SCP-209 inflicts on prey subjects is intended as a form of entertainment for the activator subject to enjoy while experiencing SCP-209's intoxicating effects. When the activator subject has consumed all the liquid within SCP-209, both boundary parameters are nullified. If still capable of motion, former prey subjects can and do flee the area with as much speed as possible. The activator subject will immediately become confused by the now empty SCP-209 and attempt to refill it with any available liquid. If the activator is successful in filling SCP-209 with approximately 88 to 91 milliliters or 3 ounces of any liquid, it will transmute into another glass of golden-brown translucent alcohol, and the cycle begins again, provided there is another potential prey subject in range. If prey subject or others disable or remove SCP-209 from the activator before they are able to refill it, SCP-209 will exit the active phase and remain empty and inert for approximately 79 hours before refilling itself by unknown means to potentially begin a new active phase. Addendum: Experiment Log 209-18.4. 3 Class D subjects appropriated for testing. 25 meter by 25 meter by 6 meter room, furnished with a single steel folding chair and SCP-209. Activator subject designated D-Act. Prey subjects designated D-Prey 1, D-Prey 2. Log begins 122 seconds following D-Act ingestion of SCP-209. 122 seconds. D-Act seats himself in the single chair provided in the room. D-Prey 1 approaches D-Act. D-Prey 2 begins exploring the room's boundaries. 188 seconds. D-Prey 1 discovers the inner boundary and is unable to approach D-Act. 194 seconds. D-Prey 2 discovers the outer boundary and is unable to reach the eastern wall. 227 seconds. D-Prey 1 begins shouting obscenities and attempts to strike D-Act. No effect. D-Prey 2 attempts to map the outer boundary. 255 seconds. D-Act describes SCP-209 as smoky. 258 seconds. D-Prey 1 begins coughing violently. D-Prey 2 approaches. 284 seconds. D-Prey 1 collapses, racked with violent coughs. An unknown black smoke-like gas is expelled from his mouth with each cough. D-Prey 2 attempts to approach D-Act. 299 seconds. D-Act describes SCP-209 as smooth. 302 seconds. D-Prey 2 appears to begin sweating profusely. D-Prey 1 continues coughing spasms. Expulsion of smoke-like substance continues from mouth, nose, eyes. 363 seconds. D-Prey 2 exuding a thick layer of a viscous, near-frictionless substance from all pores. Substance has eroded clothing, and apparently the first layer of epidermis. D-Prey 2 is unable to remain standing, falls, and attempts to staunch the flow of the unknown substance from his pores. D-Prey 1 apparently expired. Smoke-like substance continues to vent from mouth, nose, eyes. D-Act applauds intermittently. 484 seconds. Viscous substance exuded from D-Prey 2 has eroded two additional layers of skin. Wounds approximate to second and third degree burns. D-Prey 2 expresses desire to be terminated. Request denied. D-Act appears fixated on the remaining liquid of SCP-209. 522 seconds. D-Prey 2 expires. Substance appears to cease exuding from pores. D-Prey 1 ceases to expel smoke-like substance. D-Act continues drinking SCP-209. 948 seconds. D-Act consumes the last of SCP-209, immediately stands, and rushes to the body of D-Prey 1, begins clawing at the corpse with left hand, while maintaining hold of SCP-209 with the right. 954 seconds. Researchers determine that D-Act is attempting to refill SCP-209 with blood from the corpse of D-Prey 1. Per orders, one security staff member enters and neutralizes D-Act, recovering SCP-209, still in its empty state.
Item number, SCP-195. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. One case containing 17 bottles of SCP-195 exists in Foundation custody. It is kept in a number 3 secure containment locker unit in the safe class storage section of Site-1279. Access to SCP-195 requires written authorization from no fewer than 2 Level 4 personnel and accompaniment by a member of site security. Due to the untested possibility of exposure due to the inhalation of evaporated SCP-195, access requires full Level C hazmat kit, including respirator gear. It is possible that further instances of SCP-195 exist. All recovery agents are advised to make note of bottles of similar style or bearing similar labels to contained samples of SCP-195, as well as... Should further instances of SCP-195 be discovered, they are to be collected by a temporary containment team in full hazmat kit, including respirators. Description: SCP-195 is a medicinal whiskey sold by a pair of traveling salesmen in the pre-Civil War South. Various historical sources agree that the whiskey was targeted primarily to the slave catchers of that era and was advertised as having mind-enhancing properties. These sources agree that the salesmen were often driven out of town when the side effects of their concoction were discovered and were hanged for their devilish ways on at least two occasions. When a subject consumes any quantity of SCP-195, they will initially react in a manner consistent with the consumption of an equal quantity of gut rot whiskey or moonshine. Within a short span of time, timeframe varies by subject, they begin to experience heightened awareness and increased sensory input, taste, touch, smell, etc. This effect of the whiskey was advertised by its salesman and was the reason for its target audience. With this heightened sensory capability, however, comes a general decrease in impulse control and heightened fight or flight response, which has, in testing, been shown to lead to markedly increased levels of violent behavior. This response is theorized to explain the brutality shown by data expunged. D-class personnel under the effect of SCP-195 are capable of and willing to data expunged to enjoy the violence of the act. D-183578, first degree murder, rape, terminated, expressed a desire to rip the head off with my teeth. Further testing on the capacities of SCP-195 is deemed unnecessary. Late research assistant Renfield has been posthumously awarded a Foundation citation for performance above and beyond the requirements of duty. After the whiskey's effects wear off, the test subject will generally return to normal, with the exception of those who data expunged. Within a month, however, all subjects will experience a generalized feeling of ennui, coupled with fatigue. MRI scans at this stage show development of ulcer-like wounds in the stomach and lungs. These continue to spread indefinitely until the death of the subject. Additionally, the subject's skin and muscle structure begins to degrade, particularly around points of stress or motion. This degradation also continues indefinitely, or until the death of the subject. SCP-195 was discovered by the son of a historian in Alabama in late 2000. Mr. arrest and sentencing for the murder of was an item of minor interest in local news in the area. The Foundation became interested in his case when he was admitted to a hospital, at which point the unusual degradation of his skin and organs was noted by Foundation informants in the medical community and traced back to an antebellum home where he had assisted his father in cataloging various items of historical interest. A Foundation team was dispatched to the home and located an open case containing several bottles of SCP-195. Addendum. Historical sources' descriptions of the salesman seem to agree that one man was blonde and unusually tall, while the other had dark hair and walked with a stoop. Both men had strange bright eyes and wore matching clothing. All personnel are reminded that their capture is level 6 priority.
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.